Now you are exalted to the highest place, King of the heavens, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I marvel at this saving grace, and I'm full of praise once again. I'm full of praise once again.
morning, everybody, and welcome to worship. And that includes any visitors we have. And a very special welcome to those on live stream this morning. Welcome. Thank you, Patrick, for leading the communion service today. And a reminder that this will be a short service as we have a church meeting in the warm hub straight after worship. Now, this afternoon, we have messy Easter for children and families from 3 to 5. Please pray for Fliss and all the helpers as they bring the Easter message to families in our communities. Now, on Wednesday morning, meet here at 10 o'clock for Fliss's new walking group. Don't know where you're going, it's a mystery to her. But she doesn't say on here. Now, yesterday we had a coffee morning for the Nepal Leprosy Trust. And Rosemary would like to thank everyone who helped, supported or contributed to yesterday's coffee morning. A total of £530, which included some donations, was raised for the Nepal Leprosy Trust, which is excellent. Now, the warm welcome has moved into its summer routine now. You don't have to come in your Bermudas or anything, just, you know. With coffee and cake replacing soup lunches. Everyone is welcome to drop in at the warm hub between 10 and 12 on Mondays and Thursdays. There's no charge. Sorry, I said Thursday and it says Friday here. All right. Friday's just keeping you on your toes. There's no charge, just good coffee, great cakes and grand chats. Now, last November, Patrick and I were sponsored by the elders to attend a course called Leading Your Church into Growth, or LISIG for short. We found it to be an inspiring time with some excellent ideas that we would love to share with our church. So, there are 7 sessions, and we plan to run one every fortnight on Tuesday evenings, starting on the 16th of April. Everyone is warmly invited to come along as we pray and work to continue to become a growing church. Let Patrick know. Not me, I'll lose the list. don't send me an email. If you intend to come. Next Sunday, Mary Taylor will be leading our worship. And that's it all. Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie, very much indeed. We miss Margaret's weather forecast, don't we? You didn't give us a weather forecast, but no.
I just opened the curtains to look out and see.
Yeah. Margaret is coming towards the end of lambing, so no doubt she'll be back with us soon. As we gather for worship, let's join together in our call to worship with the words that are on the screen. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Rejoice, heavenly powers. Sing, choirs of angels. Rejoice, O earth, in shining splendor. Christ has conquered. Jesus Christ, our King, is risen. Glory fills you. Darkness vanishes forever. Christ is risen. Rejoice, heavenly powers. Sing, choirs of angels. Rejoice, O church. The risen Saviour shines upon you. Let this place resound with joy, echoing the mighty song of all God's people. Amen. So let's allow this place to rejoice and resound with joy as we stand to sing our first hymn, Christ is Alive. Let Christians sing. Please stand as you're able.
Thank you.
the start of our worship, let's gather in prayer. Let us pray to God. Gracious and merciful God, we come before you with humble hearts, acknowledging the doubts that linger within us and the moments when our faith wavers. In the stillness of this sacred space, we confess our shortcomings and seek your forgiveness. Like the disciples in the locked room, we sometimes find ourselves paralyzed by fear, fear of the unknown, fear of inadequacy, and fear of the challenges that lie ahead. And in those moments, Lord, we have sometimes doubted your presence and questioned your plans for us. Lord, forgive us for the times when we have struggled to fully trust your resurrection power. Forgive us for the moments when we've allowed doubt to overshadow the profound truth of your victory over death. In the spirit of Thomas, we confess that there are times when we demand tangible evidence, seeking assurance in what we can see and touch, rather than trusting in the unseen reality of your love and your grace. Father, we repent of our limited vision, and we ask for the faith to believe without always needing to see. Lord Jesus, just as you showed your wounds to Thomas, reveal to us the areas in our lives where healing and transformation are needed. Make us aware of the woundedness around us and guide us in acts of compassion, mercy, and reconciliation. May the same Spirit that breathed peace into the locked room breathe forgiveness and renewal into our hearts today. Empower us to go forth with courage, sharing the good news of your resurrection and embodying the love that casts out fear. We offer this prayer in the name of the risen Christ, who continues to transform doubt into faith and darkness into everlasting light. Amen. And we continue in worship as we bless the offering. Gracious God, provider and creator of all, in this season of celebration and rejoicing, we come with songs on our lips and praise in our hearts, seeking you and trying to bring your light to the world. And so now we offer you these tokens of money as a sign of our commitment to your mission and message in this place and in all places. Amen. We're going to listen to God's word now as we hear our first reading, which comes from John's Gospel and speaks of the events that happened immediately after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I think Alistair is going to read for us this morning. Thank you.
is John 20, verses 19 to 28. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God."
Thank you, Alistair, very much. So this Sunday, the first Sunday after Easter, is sometimes called Low Sunday. And the origins of this name, Low Sunday, are really lost in the mists of time. But we might imagine that it's a name that contrasts with the brightness and the colour and the joy and the highs of Easter worship, the great feast of Easter Sunday. Well, that may be why it's called Low Sunday, or there may be other reasons. For some people, for people in ministry, the clergy, for example, many of them who have worked extremely hard every day through Lent and Holy Week, for many of them it's a chance to have a Sunday off and let somebody else loose with the pulpit and see what they can make of it. And it's a chance to rest and recoup and recharge their batteries. Perhaps it's also called Low Sunday, though, because when we read the gospel narrative of what happened to the disciples after the resurrection, it doesn't make for particularly joyful reading. And if we think about that passage that Alistair's just read to us, I wonder how it strikes you. How would you describe the disciples in that situation that we've just heard about? John tells us that they were together, but with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. They were scared, puzzled perhaps, frightened, isolated, in hiding, locked away from the outside world. And I guess you could probably say they were feeling low. And what happens? Well, as we heard, Jesus appeared to them. Well, of course, they'd have picked up on the rumours. They'd have heard what those pesky women had been saying about Jesus, that he'd risen from the dead. But I wonder if they were believing it for themselves, because it must have sounded so fantastical. So there they are, with the doors locked, and no doubt arguments and disputes going on between them, asking about what's the best course of action to take. There were probably as many different suggestions as there were disciples present. Perhaps voices were raised. Maybe tables were thumped. Maybe disagreement was in the air. And into the locked room, through the door, through the walls, who knows, in comes Jesus. And he stands among them and says very simply, "Peace be with you." And if you notice in the gospel that we heard, he doesn't say it once, but he says it twice. "Peace be with you." Maybe he has to say it twice to get them to listen. Maybe the clamour is so noisy, there's so much going on, that he has to reinforce what he said the first time. They need to hear what he was saying. "Peace be with you." And after a little bit of peace descends, Jesus commissions them by breathing the Holy Spirit upon them, which changes everything. I wonder if we, as a group of believers, a group of followers of Jesus, can relate to how they were feeling. Can we relate to that shattered community of Christians? We've probably experienced in our lifetimes our share of trauma and fear. And if we think about ourselves as a group of, a community of Christians, a group of followers, well, we've seen the decline of the church from being a significant institution in society to something that's perhaps more marginal and ignored by many people. And there's a trauma there in seeing a church that we love decline, and a puzzle for us at why people are less interested in religion than they used to be. And that can be disconcerting, unsettling, disturbing. And perhaps we need Jesus to give us peace, just as he did to those first disciples. But if we think of those disciples who were feeling low, we also need to make a special point of looking at Thomas, considering him. Poor old Thomas. He was probably feeling considerably worse than the rest of them, because he wasn't there when Jesus first appeared to the disciples. He missed all the action. Maybe he'd gone to get some supplies. Perhaps he'd popped into the co-op to get some chocolate, because everybody knows that chocolate makes any situation feel better. Wherever he was, he missed out. And his reaction is so natural. "Unless I see for myself, I will not believe." Can you hear yourself saying those words? I could hear myself saying that. I would want to see proof, want to know for certain. There's possibly even a note of jealousy in his voice. "You others are all favoured. You've seen the Lord, but I haven't. What's wrong with me?" And how does Jesus deal with him? Well, he gives Thomas what he needs. A week later, he appears, and this time Thomas is there. And again, he comes with an exhortation of peace and then shows Thomas his wound. And Thomas has no hesitation now. "My Lord and my God," he exclaims. He has a mysterious encounter with the risen Christ that changes everything for him and transforms his outlook. Sure, the nickname Doubting Thomas will stick for centuries, but it's no longer what defines him. Instead, in the gospel, we see a man of faith proclaiming that Jesus is his Lord and his God. So what about us? What about our encounter with the risen Christ? Well, last Sunday, we decorated our Lenten cross that was stood there with flowers, and it looked fantastic. We heartily sang, "Christ the Lord is risen today," and it was beautiful. We celebrated new life by eating chocolate Easter eggs that were generously passed around the congregation, and we enjoyed them. But what is the lasting effect of our encounter with the resurrected Jesus? Just like that group of disciples quaking in a locked room, unsure of what to do next, we too will face our own challenges as a community of believers. We will have difficult decisions to make. We've got a church meeting later this morning where we'll be taking an important decision on a subject where people have very strongly held but differing views. We have to face the fact that the church in general occupies a far less significant space in society than it used to. We are less relevant and less important to large numbers of people today. At some point in the future, we will have to look at how this church is managed, how the buildings are used, how the finances are arranged, and ask ourselves if those things are still right for the church today, or whether we need to make changes. In all of these things, there will be different views. There may even be raised voices and thumping of tables. But in all of these things, we also have choices arising from our mysterious encounters with the risen Jesus. We can choose to be dominated by the trauma that we experience, or to proclaim the peaceful new life in Christ. We can choose to bicker with each other, or to be united in our purpose. We can choose to hoard what we have for the rainy day that never comes, or to share with those who are in need. We can choose to be fearful in the face of decline, or become confident in our belief that God hasn't finished with us yet. So, let's not be low this Sunday. Instead, let's be more like Thomas and look to meet anew with Jesus, our Lord and our God. This Easter time, let's decide, let's choose to change, to turn away from fears and traumas that are understandable and confront us, and instead, let's choose to serve. This Easter time, let's welcome the peace that Jesus brings to us in our fears and insecurities, and reach out to heal those who are wounded in our community. This Eastertide, let's set aside our petty divisions and unite in a common purpose to proclaim the good news of the risen Christ, who heals, brings peace, and reminds us that we are blessed in order to be a blessing to others. Amen. The music group are going to lead us in our worship, so I invite them to come forward now. And in a moment, we'll sing "How Deep the Father's Love for Us."
Please stand as you're able.
Our vast beyond.
So we come to share communion together, and all who follow Jesus are welcome to share at our table. Brothers and sisters, this isn't my table. It's not your table. It's not our table. But it is Christ's table. And because it's Christ's table, all of us are welcome here. At this table, you don't need to look a certain way. You don't have to worship a certain way or love a certain way. You don't have to believe what I believe or what the person sitting next to you believes. You just have to come exactly as you are, seeking the one who is seeking you. So come. All of you, not because you must, but because you may, and here find healing and wholeness for your journey. Christ, who was there before the universe was called into creation, Christ, who was anticipated by the prophets and prepared for by the people, Christ, who was born in a manger, baptized in the Jordan, and who calmed storms on the Sea of Galilee. Christ, who fed us all with word, with healing, with loaves, and with fishes. Christ, who saved us with an empty cross and an empty tomb. Christ, who never faded, never abandoned, never truly left us. Christ, of love, it is with you and because of you and in celebration of you that we gather around your table this morning. And gathered as we are, we pray, come, Holy Spirit, come. Bless this bread and this cup. Bless all of us in our eating and drinking at this table, that our eyes may be opened, that we may recognize the risen Christ in our midst and in each other, and be united with all for whom Christ died. Amen. And so we remember that on the morning of Jesus' resurrection, the women took spices that had been prepared and went to his tomb. There they found that the stone had been rolled away and that his tomb was now empty. There they found two men with faces shining like lightning, who said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" There, the women remembered Jesus' words that the Son of Man must be crucified and on the third day be raised again. And so this morning we remember the story of Jesus' resurrection and the story leading up to it. And remembering this story, we gather around this table and we break bread. And we pour wine. And we are made whole. And we give thanks that everything Jesus did was for love and was for us. And so with great joy, I proclaim in Jesus' name that these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready. We'll eat the bread as we receive it. we'll retain our cups to drink together as a sign of our unity. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Let us share his cup together. Christ, to this table we've come, and at this table we've been fed, and because of this table we have been made whole. From this table we will sing your glory as Easter people, giving thanks for your saving love and praying as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we continue in prayer as we pray for others, for people and situations that are on our mind. So let us pray together. Loving God, in this season of Easter, may we make time to rejoice in our risen Saviour, to celebrate and to give thanks. But may we also make time to bring you our prayers, prayers in this troubled time for ourselves and for others. This week we've seen so often on the television that war continues, hunger persists, and disease ravages. Father, we pray for our world, for all those who are impacted by the actions of those who care more for their own reputation or wealth or lifestyle than they do for the lives of their brothers and sisters in need. Help them, we pray, to find comfort and charity in their neighbours, and that those with the power to create change will do so for the good of all peoples. As we look on at our war zones in helplessness, we pray for all leaders, elected and unelected. Father, help them to see the destruction, the pain, and the conflict that arises from their actions. Bring change in their hearts, Lord, we pray. Help them to do your will. And us. We pray for our communities. We pray for this church and all our churches. Asking for discernment for a path forward in the mission field of this and all countries. Sustain us, Lord, and guide us, we pray. Embolden us to see past barriers and setbacks, to recognize opportunities and hope, and to see that with your help and your message, we have something vital to tell the world. In the confidence that we are called and that we are heard, in silence, we bring to you the prayers in each of our hearts. And as we each sit here in this building and in our homes, we come together searching for something beyond ourselves. As we carry with us doubts as well as hopes, we pray for your constant support, that you will guide us through our lives in Jesus' name and for his sake, this day and all days. Amen. Our closing hymn is Crown Him with Many Crowns, a hymn of triumph. As we're able, please stand to sing.
So let us rise up into resurrection from those low places, finding for each of us the promise that lifts us. May we hold each other, helping the weary and the weak, and rise together. May we follow the eagle with wings spread out and find ourselves running, flying, soaring, free together. Amen.